Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's now my honor and distinct privilege to introduce our Vice Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral Bill Moran. I first met Admiral Moran in Hawaii in 2003 when he was the Executive Assistant to the U.S. Pacific Command Commander, Admiral Tom Fargo, who happened to be a scratch golfer. We had many good discussions about the merits of excellent turf on golf courses, and Bill was a teacher and I was a student. Long story for another time. Vice Chiefs in 81 graduated in Naval Academy and received a master's degree from the National War College. He's a P-3 pilot, commanded Patrol Squadron 46, Reconnaissance Wing 2. He also served extensively as an instructor pilot in multiple operational tours. As a flag officer, Admiral Moran served as Commander Patrol and Reconnaissance Group and Director of Air Warfare Division OPNAV N-98. His most recent assignment before becoming the Vice Chief of Naval Operations was Chief of Naval Personnel, Deputy Chief of Naval Operations for Manpower, Personnel, Training, and Education, OPNAV N-1. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving a very warm welcome to our Vice Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral Bill Moran.
Well, I got to tell you, since the theme of the symposium is distributed lethality, it's only appropriate to let you know that when I met Barry out in Hawaii and we played golf, he was the epitome of distributed lethality. Balls were going everywhere. It wasn't about the grass. He could never find it. So thanks for the kind introduction, Barry. Swole boss, where are you? There you are. Hey, thanks for the invitation to come out today. It's very kind of you to invite an aviator to this wonderful event. I'll do my best. All this surface stuff, though, is a bit scary, and I'll get into that in a little bit. You know, you guys truly are the Navy brand. When you think about the Marine Corps, you think about the infantrymen, you think about the Navy, anywhere you go. American public thinks about ships. It's certainly not the Blue Angels. When I talk to crowds about the Blue Angels, they go, man, it's a cool Air Force. You talk about flying airplanes off carriers, they go, I didn't know the Air Force flew off carriers. You talk about the Navy, they talk about ships. And so it's, but just keep that admission on my part in this room, please. I'd like to start with a little exercise here. Would all the veterans in the room just raise your hand? Okay. And how about anybody who served in the Cold War, stand up. All right. Yeah, hold on, don't sit down. Now, if you didn't serve in Vietnam, sit down. And if you weren't in the Navy during Korea, please sit down. Well, Hogg, what are you sitting down for? That counts. All right, how about a round of applause for our oldest vets in here? Huh? So when Tom Roden invited me to speak today, he said, you got 15 minutes, Vice Chief. And I said, Tom, how the hell am I going to say everything I know about surface warfare in 15 minutes? And he said, I'd just speak real slow if I were you. So I'm going to take my time. I'm going to take my time, Tom. It really is a great time for a symposium here, especially this year. Here we are 10 days away from our constitutional responsibility to change leadership at the highest levels. And it sets, of course, no matter how you view it, it sets enormously high expectations. And with that comes high anxiety for a lot of folks. But it's also, for us, a time of opportunity, I think. And I would add a time for caution. There is no more vulnerable period of time in our nation's history, when you think about it, than during administration transitions, especially the last 20 or 30 years. We've seen that over and over again. So we've got a Navy that must be sharp on watch all around the globe, and on watch in important waters that everybody in this crowd is familiar with, You're talking about the East Med, the Red Sea, the Gulf, South China Sea. There's a lot going on out there, and our surface warriors are making us proud every single day. In the news this week, just the day before yesterday, we had more probing, testing by forces in the Arabian Sea. And I got to tell you, once again, our COs, our crews are making great, smart, judgmental decisions. And we're not seeing escalation. We're not getting ourselves into a fight we don't need. And I got to hand that to the leadership and the training that's going on out there. But I'm really, really proud of what I'm seeing out there. And in this hall, in the training institutions, I heard John, you gave a great pitch this morning. I wish I were here for that. Can you come to my office tomorrow and give it to me again? And in fleet concentration areas, and I'll talk about that in a little bit, there's a real tangible sense of enthusiasm and optimism in the surface force. So especially on this front, talking about enthusiasm and optimism, it's an exciting time to be here and to talk about the Navy we have and the Navy we hope to have here in the future. There's also reason to believe that there's some hopefulness out there when it comes to sequestration going away, budget-based agreements going away. Maybe we won't have a 10th consecutive continuing resolution to deal with, and maybe we'll get to some stability in budgeting in the future, which allows, of course, for greater fiscal stability, which a lot of the folks in industry are very interested in, and so are we. But we need that to better balance the risks we see in the current environment and in the future environment as we look to build a Navy. So today I want you to walk away from here with three basic themes. They're pretty easy to understand, even for an aviator. Size matters is one. Two, size really doesn't matter unless it's whole. And people matter most of all. So those are the three themes I'm going to hit on today. The case, though, has been laid out here today that our ability to control the sea is being challenged. I think Tom made that pretty apparent this morning in his pitch. That our ability to protect the homeland, strategic interests, and our national values around the world is no longer without major competition. From non-state actors operating with high-end weapons, think Mason and NITSE in the Bab el-Mandeb here recently. The growing regional threats and higher-end adversaries, the world in which we operate has changed extensively since 2012. And our ability to operate anywhere in the world unconstrained no longer exists. And our need for a distributed force grows year after year after as longer range and asymmetric capabilities emerge all across the world stage. What Tom Rowden and Admiral Davidson are designing is a more distributed force, a force that recognizes that the likelihood we will fight across the globe in the future is more likely than one where we're fenced in to somebody's backyard on the other side of the globe. And the speed of threats and, in some cases, unpredictable threat actions mean we must be there to make a difference early enough to keep the fight from coming to our shores. In addition to modern capabilities and well-trained, ready forces, this type of fleet design makes the most out of our fleet's true capacity. And I want to dive in on that here in a minute. The intended output of that design is sea control, deterrence, and the ability to respond quickly to crisis, from crisis to crisis, from mobile, sovereign U.S. territory anywhere in the world. That's not new. But what is new is the energy we're putting behind having a smaller force than we're used to, being able to accomplish the same mission over time. So 274 ships. We undoubtedly do not have enough Navy to meet the demand. If you think about New York City and firehouses, there's 250 today in New York City. If they were to have to operate with 200, could they respond in time to emerging crises? How many lives would be lost with 200 firehouses instead of 250? Capacity, location, presence, size matters in this business. We have a very similar situation in the Navy today. Like firefighters in New York City, the size of the force to deter conflict and provide credible options to National Command Authority worldwide certainly must and does matter. If we just look at the Pacific and you work your way west from the California coast and you overlay three U.S. territories across, you still don't get to China. It's a big ocean requiring a lot of ships. And we also have to do that while we're looking across the rest of the globe, whereas if you truly believe that potential adversaries are going to operate in other parts of the globe while we're focused on another one, we're going to need to be more present than we ever were. So all of that recognition that size matters and the size of the fleet and the growing threats that that you've heard about and you'll continue to read about, in 2012 and 2014, we assessed what it would take to keep the other guy from exploiting the sea for their own advantage. And that told us we needed about 308 ships to meet that mission. Since then, though, the world's changed, as we've talked about. In 2016, this past year, based on the complex and changing security environment, we took another look. Started over a year ago. Unfortunately, we have military people in and out of uniform who do this sort of planning routinely. So we went out and we asked the combatant commanders, what do they need from their maritime forces? And it all added up to 700 plus ships. But we all know that's fiscally unrealistic. So we had to take another look. We had to look at risk, where we would accept risk, and then where we might have duplication. And in the end, our analysis showed we needed 350 ships or more. Now, there are a lot of folks out there who, when they heard that number, it was because it was released fairly recently. They heard that number and they thought, well, that's convenient, since the new administration has used that number, 350. So no matter where you think that number came from, I can assure you that our analysis has been going on for a year. And we came up with it, and we stand by that work. And much of it is classified, and I won't talk about that aspect of it here. But that number is real. Mid-300s has been around for a while in various different analyses. But right now, when we really looked at the global threat and the reemergence of older adversaries, that number of 350, just the ship count, and there are other components and capabilities in addition to that ship count that came into that analysis. In addition to this force structure assessment, we're also wrapping up three independent future fleet architecture studies. I think some of you have read about it or have heard it. But all three of those, independent, without any collaboration or guidance from OPNAV staff, came up with roughly the same number. So we feel pretty comfortable with the number we're looking at, somewhere in the mid-300s. There's no doubt that the ship count is an important metric. But I would caution we can't get too overly excited about the potential for that much money coming our way anytime soon. My priority, our priority in the near term, when that money does come, if it does come, has got to be fleet readiness. When we make decisions that either directly or indirectly underfund our readiness accounts, we do not get the full value from our Navy. Phil Davidson, Admiral Phil Davidson out of Fleet Forces, makes that abundantly clear at every opportunity with me. And if you know Phil, when it's abundantly clear from Phil, it's abundantly clear. And he's passionate about it. So is the SWO boss. And so is the Air boss, by the way. This affects aviation as well as it does the surface force. During the past several years, under the strain of insufficient funding and budget uncertainty, we've not been able to fully fund what we really need. We're lucky on any given year to have had 90% funding across our readiness accounts. And 90% of 274 is about 246. And if you do the math, if it takes three to make one on deployment, that number gets you to 82. We haven't deployed less than 90 ships in the last 15 years on a daily basis. So 274 doesn't get you close. It gets you even less close when you can't fund the readiness accounts. So that number that I use of 90 plus is answering a demand by the COCOMs at a level of 40%. So we're only meeting 40% of the COCOM demand at 90 plus ships a day deployed around the globe. So after a number of years at funding readiness at 90%, 90% of 90% of 90%, you can see where the math goes. It doesn't end up in a good place, especially when op tempo has not changed a bit. Everybody in here who's operated out in the fleet in the last 10 years knows we have not slowed down. And yet the infamous number of on 9/11 of 316 ships, and we're still operating in the same tempo. We got 274 today. I'm an English major, but I can figure that out pretty quick. And we've got 90,000 fewer sailors in the fleet than we did on 9/11. All that adds up to higher stress, deferred maintenance, and higher costs. And we are our own worst enemy. And we're also proud of the culture of getting things done. The can-do spirit of the Navy is everywhere. But we also never cry uncle, which sometimes works against us. I wouldn't trade the two, though. It's up to leadership, like CNO and myself and everybody in the front row here, to be willing to say we've got to turn back some of this op tempo so we can pay attention to our maintenance. And that's where we're focused. Now, SWO boss has done a, you know, it's not because he's sitting in the front row, I'm going to give him a hug here, but, you know, when you look at where we were a year ago on Macon Island, I think they had 60 CAS reps. Today, they deployed here recently. I just was on board Macon Island. They deployed with less than 10 CAS reps. We're getting our act together. It's working. And you go around the fleet and you can see signs of this in places, but there are also places it's not working so well. But the point here is this is a long war we've been in. We've got emerging and re-emerging threats that have all raised the stakes on making this long game even longer. And we're not going to be able to stay healthy if we don't pay attention to our maintenance accounts. That 274 or that 308 or that 350 is not going to be the same number at readiness levels that we have today, readiness funding levels that we have today. Deferred maintenance is insidious. Takes a toll on the long-term readiness of the fleet. Let me give you a couple examples. Albany, LA-class submarine. I know where it is a ship. 28-month availability turned into 48 months. During that 48 months, the CO retired, the XO and the engineer failed to promote, and many of the sailors on that crew never deployed. You can't buy that back. It's tough on our surface warfare community as well. You know better than me, if you miss an availability and your time in the yards is cut short to get back in the rotation, the problems continue to compound. So by the time your next availability comes around, it takes even longer and costs even more. A couple examples, Carter Hall, LSD. Out of Norfolk, header availability nearly doubled from 364 days to 673. And a cost increase of $70 to $125 million. Now, part of that was because of a bow wave of pre-existing maintenance backlog that we didn't get to earlier, totaling $30 million. Russell, out of San Diego, had a 92-day avail schedule. We're at 459 and counting. $8 million planned. $89 million in counting. Carter Hall and Russell also had large maintenance backlogs totaling $22 million. This is not going to get any better unless we can reset that force, especially the maintenance and modernization that comes with it. Both of those ships, Carter Hall and Russell, lost a full year of operational availability. So it's really hard to see the light at the end of this tunnel. Fewer steaming hours for training, to pay for deployed hours, deferred maintenance, spending more time in the yards is necessary. All takes time away from our young sailors to learn a new system, increase their proficiency at sea, and get qualified. As I said, you can't buy that back. At some point, we just simply have to dig in and dig out of this problem. Now, all that sounds like a lot of doom and gloom, and I understand that. But the real point is that when the transition team came around to all of us in the building and asked us what we could do with more money right now, the answer was not to buy more ships. The answer was to make sure that the 274 that we had were maintained and modernized to provide 274 ships worth of combat power. Then we'll start buying more ships. They heard that loud and clear, I hope. Now, assuming we get that readiness stable and predictable, and we must, future threats will face demand that every ship out there will continue to see in terms of growth, and will really make it difficult in terms of being able to provide the deterrence and sea control that we talk about in Tom's distributed lethality and his vision for the future force. So between Tom Roden's remarks and Ron Boxall's brief this morning, what's exciting about the concept of distributed lethality is that today's technology allows us to employ our surface ships like never before in asymmetric ways. While they've always operated helicopters and delivered boats, the ability to deploy and operate unmanned systems in the air, on the surface, and underwater has the potential to change the way we fight in the future. And that potential is captured inside the surface fleet vision and Admiral Davidson's concept of distributed maritime operations. Now, our incredible laboratories around the country, and we need to pay attention in our business to our labs. We talk a lot about innovation. We complain about the lack of innovation. We seek ways to innovate more. We have to connect the fleet, and I'm talking junior officers and mid-level enlisted, to our labs. We've got to make a concerted effort to. There's some great work going on by extraordinarily smart engineers who want to take us to the next level. But they're experimenting, for example, up at Newark in Newport, on the latest UUV concepts, many of which are intended to be launched and recovered from surface ships, enabling our surface warriors to operate not just in the two dimensions, but three-dimensional warfare. Now, all of this, of course, has to be balanced. Finding the right fit for the right platforms at the right price that we can afford. This is tough business. But we also can't forget about the sensors, the communication systems, and the cyber-protected and jam-resilient networks that we've got to have to be able to operate in that distributed fashion. But we are, thankfully, moving rapidly in the right direction, organizing on OPNAV and in the fleet around these concepts, pulling ourselves out of the traditional stovepiped programming and analysis that we've done in the past, trying to stay focused on informing our tactical decisions with strategic decisions. The kind of strategic thinking you just heard from Frank Pandolf. And we prioritize readiness and change, as we prioritize readiness and change how we apply firepower and that lethality, and how we fight, the most important component of just how effective we will be tomorrow and in the future is, of course, our people that John Wade spoke passionately about this morning. And I know Tom Roden speaks passionately about every single day. When I say people, I mean our sailors, our Navy civilians, our engineers, our yard workers, academia, and industry, who's in here today. Together, we all form what is clearly our greatest asymmetric advantage, the talent of our people. If I were a bit younger, had bad hair, worse eyes, and no longer had the urge to slip the surly bonds of Earth, I'd be a surface warfare officer. It's an exciting time. You laughing at me or are you laughing at yourselves? Ron? Now, I'm dead serious about this. I see it everywhere I've been in the fleet, and I've been around the fleet a lot in the last three and a half years. Every time I would call before a trip, I'd call Tom Roden, I'd say, where do you not want me to go? Get me to a bad ship. I want to see where it's not working. And he failed on every single occasion. Macon Island in the Gulf of Aden just a month ago. And I was on Macon Island a year and a half ago for another reason, but incredible spirit on that crew. Got to see Halsey in the Pacific a month ago. Preble and Pearl, Essex and Normandy in the Gulf, Reagan and Yokosuka. Unbelievable talent, spirit, teamwork going on in the fleet. The energy that I saw, especially, and the feedback I got, especially in the wardrooms and our junior officers, affirmed the trends that we've seen for the past few years. Our sailors are looking for meaningful adventure and purpose. They're looking for variety. They want to be smart, creative, and innovative. And for our surface force, well, we're providing exactly that on many different fronts. Still got a long way to go, but we're going in the right direction. The renewed focus on tactics with what you heard from John Wade this morning and the weapons tactics instructors is a great direction for this community. As a proud aviator, my first instinct is to look at the SWO WTI program and say, what the heck took you so long? It worked well for us. But, all kidding aside, naval aviation was compelled after Korea and Vietnam when we were failing in combat to stand up Top Gun in the WTI program. Don't let that happen to you. Embrace this idea. It's going to work over time. I guarantee you. As those junior officers become department heads, become XOs, become COs, become Commodores over the next 10, 15 years, you will really begin to feel the momentum shift in a positive way. So America expects us to fight and win, but aviation learned we could not take our technology and our size for granted. We outnumbered them, we had better technology, but we had to get smarter and we had to be better tactically than the enemy. It's motivating to be the best at your job and to teach others. And that helps keep our best and brightest in this business we call the Navy. And when we have the best and brightest empowered to teach and innovate, our warfighting gets that much better. My most satisfying tours, I think all of us who have had the opportunity to instruct, those tours are the most satisfying tours you'll ever have. Not only do you build expertise in your community, and the effectiveness goes up over time, but you even leave a little bit of legacy as an instructor. That, as many of you in this room know today, we live off that legacy for a very, very long time. As our young students, whoever they were, move on and move up in this organization and become leaders in their own right, there's nothing better on the planet. It's the reason we all stick around. I recently had a surface warfare CEO tell me very grudgingly that he actually had JOs whose tactical areas approached his own. Imagine that. Frankly, that's the way it should be. It's the way it should be. Our senior officers may have more experience, but the benefit of junior officers refreshing the knowledge base with the latest and greatest tactics and then spreading that knowledge is absolutely indispensable to our ability of our fleet. We all know people want to be part of a winning team, and part of a learning organization is one that listens to sailors with ideas about how to make the team better. The results of this empowerment lead to success. In just 3 years, the SWO department head screening board went from if you breathe, you got selected, to arguably one of the most selective boards we have in the Navy. More folks are staying, which means the competition's going up. That's all good for us. And all of this, of course, didn't happen overnight. It was enabled by the foundation of all of you who stood up early. All of you Cold War vets, you Vietnam vets, you Korean vets. Started with you. Your legacy is what is taking us to the next level. And now that culture is starting to really grab a hold. It's real, it's effective, and all of us must embrace it, encourage it, and live it, no matter what our background is. So let me close where we started. This is a really exciting time. That sense of opportunity is in the air, but we cannot make this mistake of focusing solely on a bigger Navy. The money may or may not be there. I don't know. Don't ask me that question in a few minutes. I don't know. None of us do. But part of my job is to keep a weather eye on afloat and ashore readiness, ensuring all of the important enabling accounts are sufficient to operate this fleet. If we are fortunate enough to grow in size, improve our readiness, and advance our tactical expertise, it is our people who will take us there. There are many young sailors all over the fleet innovating and finding capabilities to extend the reach of our Navy and give us a greater punch at the end of the day. Those same young men and women are embracing mastery of their talents, challenging tactical primacy formerly reserved for more senior officers, showing that our people are still the most important element of an effective, powerful, and strong Navy. So during the rest of the symposium and going forward from here, please remember, size matters, but size doesn't matter if it's not whole, and people matter more than anything else. I'm ready for your questions. Thank you very much. Okay, the light is bright. I got all kinds of time. Please identify yourself because I can't see you.
Yes. Sydney Freeberg, ladies first.
Okay.
Hi, my name is Hope Hodgsack. I'm with military.com. I wanted to follow up on your comments about deferred maintenance and the issues there. I know some of it is due to backlogs and budget issues and things that are beyond control, but I guess I had a two-part question. First of all, are there things that you're looking at doing differently from the Navy's point of view to avoid those problems in the future? And second, there's been some reporting about the current temporary carrier gap in the Middle East and how that's related to the same issue. And I was wondering if you could expound on what risks, I guess, are undertaken when something like that happens.
Well, Hope, you kind of answered your own question to an extent, right? So all the topics you just brought up are connected. The gaps we've seen that we've accepted and taken risk in are, you know, operational risk that we've taken, are related to the fact that we all recognize that if we keep extending deployments and turning people around faster than our schedule, that we'll never dig out of that maintenance backlog. So we're purposefully taking risk from time to time to make sure that we don't get deployments extended beyond 7 months. We get those ships back, we get them in maintenance, and we commit to the funding to make sure the maintenance gets done and the modernization that goes with it. So if we don't stick to that plan, everything I talked about earlier just continues to spiral down, and the bow waves continue, and then the yards are not manned or equipped and modernized as well to be able to deal with that backlog. So yesterday, Admiral Davidson and I and Admiral Swift's team out of PAC Fleet, every month we get together for a maintenance executive council, and we talk about funding, we talk about schedule, we talk about investments in the yards and our people. All of those things are being measured against the money we have available to be able to invest in all of those accounts to make maintenance, to get our ships out on time, in and out on time, and try to capture the growth that we've seen over the last 10 years in those maintenance accounts. Admiral Roden can probably talk about this in his sleep, about all of those things, but from the big picture, if we don't reduce the op tempo sufficient enough to make sure that those ships can get back in for the maintenance, then we'll never recover from that. Okay? Sir.
Sydney Friedberg, Breaking Defense. I want to pull on the readiness thread as well and zoom in on one particular thing you said about, you know, your message to the transition team. You collectively, the Navy leadership, was, you know, right now what we need is not more ships, although we have our 355 force assessment.
No, Sydney, but I didn't say that.
But we need, okay.
What did I say? Size matters.
Size matters, but it's not like the first dollar is going to go to readiness if you get a choice where to put it.
Yeah. So doesn't mean we don't need more ships.
Right.
Okay? So because it's all connected. I don't mean to interrupt you, but I love doing it.
So how do you balance those? Because there's only so many dollars.
Too small a Navy means we drive op tempo higher on that smaller Navy. Remember I said in 9/11 we had 316 ships. Today we have 274.
Right.
And we're deploying the same number of ships over that same amount of time. Mm-hmm. That math does not add up, right? So we need a bigger Navy so that we can continue to meet demand without driving the current force, the smaller force, into the ground because we don't have enough ships to replenish that presence that we're trying to accommodate to the COCOMs. So, yes, the first thing we need to do is reinforce the foundation, which is our readiness, the maintenance of the ships we have today. And then we can, in conjunction with that, so it's colors of money, it's the length of time it gets the contract out. If we get money in 17, the only way we're going to be able to execute that money is to throw it at things that we can throw money at right now, and that's readiness. We could put ships into more avails. We could put more modernization there. It's ready. It's available. We don't have the money in for some of those contracts right now. So we can. My point is, we're going to put money in that readiness and modernization account right away. And we're also going to try to fare in opportunities to buy more ships of many different types simultaneously. But our first priority has got to be to reinforce the foundation, which is our current fleet. Sorry, I jumped on you there, but do you have a follow-up? You sat down, so I'm... So we know precisely how much money we need in our readiness accounts to be able to execute the full magnitude of what our yards can handle for ship maintenance and modernization in 17 and 18. So that number's pretty well understood. The any money that comes on top of that, we can start looking at how we would contract out for ships we think we could, yards and contractors are ready to start building, you know, this year or next. And there are certain types of ships that we can start doing that. You'd buy the advanced procurement, you start the process, you get them on contract. We're going to do that in parallel with the readiness, but it is about money. You got to have enough to do both. Thanks for the question. Yes, sir.
Hello, Dave Edwards, Arx Enterprises. More than 20 years ago, we trained our sailors in depth on the equipment. Then when OEMs would back away from having tech reps for those sailors were able to maintain those systems essentially indefinitely. Since those 20 years, we've stopped training those sailors as well as we used to. The sailors are still bright, probably brighter than they ever have been with the education they're able to get now. Now we're not able to maintain the systems. When we show up on ships as contractors, we see the sailors and the equipment not in material readiness. That compounds your problems in the availabilities because the ships aren't ready for the availabilities. Not only that, as the industrial base, we always relied on the services to be able to recruit those sailors after they retired or after they left the services to give them back to you to keep that investment you made in the training paying. We can't recruit people now who know how to fix the gear. They're not being taught in the military anymore. Do you see any way to kind of flip the switch back to giving them the training they need to sustain your equipment, lower your risk and your availabilities, and help the industrial base have the people you need back to you later? Thank you, sir.
Yeah, great question. Let me give full credit to the service community leadership. And it started, Tom, I'd say maybe 5 years ago, 6 years ago, with the recognition that our training was falling short. And we've put a lot of investment in our schoolhouses and in the length of training of many of our rates that are important to maintaining those high-end systems. But when you get a fire controlman training pipeline that exceeds 2 years, you really got to question the effectiveness of that training and whether there's a lot of dead time. So we're doing a lot of time looking at where folks are sitting around waiting for training to start, because that's ineffective training by its own right. So there's a lot of work going on right now in the training environment. I'm very encouraged by what I'm seeing out of SURF-4, SURF-LANT, from the schools and the warfighting development centers that are focused on this. But one of the things that Admiral Roden did when he was resource sponsor and other resource sponsors behind him have followed suit is to try to invest in opportunities where sailors, when they leave that first tour, have an opportunity to go somewhere to continue to build on those skills. So our SIMAs are a place where we took a lot of risk in years ago. For, you know, and everybody that comes before us makes decisions for a lot of reasons. So I never impugned those decisions. But the recognition that we had sailors in highly skilled rates that weren't able to come off of sea duty and go to shore duty and continue to work in that skill set drives down the overall experience level in the fleet over time. So we've bought back a bunch of those opportunities. And Admiral Roden knows this very well, and he can probably speak at great length about where we bought them and how we're starting to see those being populated today. We have to continue to look for those opportunities, especially if we're able to grow the Navy in the future. We're going to have to buy that back and buy into that so that those places can take full advantage. Then I think you'll start to see that level come up. And then we also have to modernize the way we train. You know, we're in a little bit of tension right now about how to do that best. But my strong belief is that if you don't put that training on the waterfront or on the flight line, you're going to be inefficient and ineffective over the long haul. Trying to cycle people in and out of schools at great distances often runs into problems with the ability for ships, crews to let those people go. And then you end up with ineffective training. So we're trying to capture all of that in this, in what we're already doing and what we're looking at doing in the future. Okay? It's a very important question. Thank you.
I think I'm over here.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Admiral Evan Thompson from Corps Defense. Last year during SNA, our Navy and our nation had a pretty embarrassing incident over the Arabian Sea. Over the course of last year, pretty extensive investigation was done. Some pretty decisive actions were taken. Can you explain what kind of training has occurred in the Navy to ensure that our warriors are trained properly, have a proper warrior ethos, so nothing like that happens again?
Yeah, I mean, from the macro standpoint, we've learned a lot of lessons from two very significant investigations that went on post that incident. Admiral Davidson, the NACC Force Commander, Admiral Roden, and others have taken a very deep look at how we have prepared people to go on deployment, and then once we get them in theater, to make sure we sustain that training over the long haul. Those were all hard lessons that we have built back in. I get a report about once a quarter over a series of several dozen steps that were identified in those investigations to be resolved. And we're down in a handful now, so I'm pretty comfortable we've answered most of those. But you know, this is about leadership, and it's about making sure that we're given the adequate resources so that they can train and be ready to go on deployment. And once they get on deployment, to make sure we sustain that training. Anybody else? Okay.
I'm on the board at SNA, so we were all told we better make sure we ask questions to keep you here as long as we can. So, I'm Hank Giffen. I'm a retired vice admiral. That's really not true, by the way, but it is a feeling that we all have that if nobody else will ask you questions, we will. I asked Admiral Roden this question earlier, and he had a very complimentary answer to the support he's getting, but clearly that the distributed lethality is not just a surface warfare program. You know, it includes N2, N6, keep going on, you know, 87, 88, and NAVC, the whole basic support structure, all the codes and modes, whatever, of the Navy. And I asked him again, as I said earlier, you know, what kind of support he was getting, and he was very complimentary and even said he was going to go to Tailhook. And when I was Surfland, I would have given half of a body part, vital body part, to go and be able to not just to go to the event, but to basically mix with the aviators and try to get to understand what they're thinking and the direction they're going. What are you and the CNO doing to make sure that this program succeeds, that he gets the right support? Because he clearly, you know, Surface Navy cannot do it alone. And yet all these other organizations have their own priorities and their own, you know, really, I mean, very limited budget and so on.
Yeah, Hank, terrific question. I would say it starts with, if you believe in the strategic and operational approach that's being brought forward, and then you prioritize your programming and budgeting along the strategic lines, then we'll see that support continue. And we're also reorganizing pieces of the OTMAF staff to support the whole concept of distributed lethality. Underneath the design that Admiral Davidson is putting out there called distributed maritime operations. So they all fit well together. I think Admiral Davidson's speaking here at the banquet. So great place to ask him this question about the design. You know, I heard CNO today in front of the entire OPNAV leadership say, read this document from Admiral Davidson live it, breathe it, and we need to strategize and program against it. Okay, so we've tried to take that approach in how we build a POM. It's a tough cultural shift in OPNAV. It's a messy year to do it because we got three kind of crazy budgets competing right now. But I think if you look at how we're organized on the OPNAV staff today, with approaching the POM for 19 and potentially redoing 18, not potentially, we will redo 18. It's all going to be driven by the strategic approach that we've laid out in what N35 is deriving from, not only a maritime strategy documents, but also these concept of operation documents. So this is a new one. It's going to be feathered in, if you will, to how we approach the programming piece. Those mechanics and those processes have to work if a concept like distributed lethality is going to live long term. Organization on the OPNAV staff, you'll see it in air warfare, you'll see it in N2 and 6 in cyber warfare, in information warfare, and networks. They're all collaborating on this concept in one form or another. There are different forms of it out there in terms of NIFCA, whether you're talking about from the sea or from the air, or now even under the sea. Those are all, if you kind of look at them together, they all kind of make sense in terms of just be able to distribute the force and put the right weapon on the right target at the right time and keep the enemy guessing, because you've got to look at a lot more things. So long answer to your question.
Oh,
the short answer is yes, we are absolutely committed to this, and it's being driven by how we program. And that, at the end of the day, you know that if money's not laid against it, it's just a good idea.
Right.
Okay.
Sure.
Thanks for the question.
Thank you.
I have a question on this side.
Mike Fierro,
11th yes, sir.
Company. 11th Company.
Good 11th Company, Tigers. Yes, sir. Hey, thanks for bringing back the ratings.
Thanks, CNO.
We appreciate the courage it took to get that decision reversed. So thank you very much.
Okay, Mike, let me tell you what courage is admitting that you've learned something and that you needed to change. Okay? It's tough. It's tough. But CNO did that. Dave?
Vice Chief Dave Hart from Deloitte Consulting and the SNA Symposium Committee. Probably the toughest critics you typically face is when you have to cross the river and wind up on the hill. And I'd be curious if you could share with us, as you think about it, some of the very toughest questions you've had to answer, either from the SASC or the SAC or any of the others, that really zero in on areas that are particularly of concern to you.
Dave, there's not a day that goes by, it seems, where we don't get tough questions on issues from the Hill. But I truly welcome those questions. I think when you get the tough questions, it forces you to think. If they were easy questions, I'd really question whether we have the right tension. So friction is necessary to move. And that, I wouldn't call it friction, I just think it's a wonderful way. Well, wonderful, maybe not the right word. It's a way of engaging in a dialogue to make sure that the American public understands what we think is important and we understand what the American public thinks is important. One of my biggest concerns when I was CNP, and I continue to believe this, is that we have a civ-mil divide in our country growing every day. When 84% or so of our new recruits are from military bloodlines, that is not healthy for our country or our military, even though the recruits we get are fabulous, because we know who they are. Where's the rest of America? Congress is not much different. You look at the numbers of veterans in Congress, it's starting to creep up a little bit, but we're at a nadir when it comes to experience and familiarity with who we are as an institution, as a profession. So the more of those tough questions that come from them, the more opportunity we have to engage and show them and tell them who we are, and then make sure we're listening to them to understand what the American public really thinks. And then, of course, you have to work the politics out. Politics are what they are, and we all understand that. So I'm not answering your question. There The toughest part about working across the river is the full acknowledgement and realization that there are two parties. It's not a unified body, that you're only talking to one piece. You're working multidimensional all the time in that body, and you really do have to spend a lot of time listening. And you can't go in there, in my view, with an absolute position. You have to go in there with a position that you feel pretty strongly about, and then try to figure out where you can find common ground and be able to get a position that you can live with. This is never perfect. That goes on the program side. It's always frustrating when there's a sense by the questions that are coming our way that we don't understand how to do acquisition and procurement. Everything's costing too much, taking too long, all those things. Well, you know, we believe that too. But we've got some fabulous people working these issues every single day, working with industry to try to drive costs down. And frankly, the conversation usually turns to, hey, 9 consecutive CR, sequestration, budget-based agreements. There's no stability in our ability to have this conversation with you, because there's no baseline. There's no common baseline. We haven't had one in 9 or 10 years, so it's really hard to have that procurement discussion. Social issues always come up in one form or another. We've all read about them. Those are tough discussions because it's cultural. It's our professional culture inside the military. It's different from the culture outside the military, and we just have to get everybody to understand the differences and then try to get to the right place at the end of the day. So that's in the macro view. There's hundreds of issues, though, Dave, as you know. Thanks for the question. Admiral Hawk.
I'd rather not, by the time I walk back there, I'm going to ask the question.
Yes, sir. Yeah, so Admiral Hogg asked if there's one way to reduce the pressure on the op tempo is more FDNF. And frankly, in the last several years, our FDNF numbers have gone up. You think about Rota, you think about Singapore, you got Coronado in Singapore today. We're going to put a couple more in there over time. That's effective FDNF that will work. But I think you well know that if we try to go somewhere where the capacity doesn't exist or the facilities don't exist at all, it's billions of dollars to generate an FDNF capability, schools, commissaries, hospitals, and then training facilities, all that. There's no question that once you get it there, the return on that investment is very, very good over time, especially operationally. And we see what we get out of the FDNF ships. It's wonderful. It's reduced some of the stress back on this coast for sure. So, yeah, we are looking at opportunity. We do this in a very structured process, and we revisit it over and over and over again and look for opportunities. And we especially look for opportunities where allies and partners are willing to flip the bill for some of that infrastructure that goes with it. And you know we have some great support in places around the world. Thanks for the question. Okay, Barry, I think I've run them out. I've run them dry. Thank you very much, everybody. Have a great symposium.